Unit 2. Appu and his loving family. Reading. This is a story of Appu, a boy born in a poor but loving family in a village in Bengal. When his father leaves for the city to pursue his dream of becoming a playwright, Appu's mother struggles to take care of him, his sister Durga, and his elderly aunt. This is an extract from the novel Patheer Panchali, written by Vidhuti Bhushan Bandopadhyay. It tells us how Appu spent his summer afternoons. Some distance from Appu's house stood a huge peepal tree. You could only see its top if you looked through the window along the corridor or from the raised terrace in front of the house. Appu would find himself gazing at it from time to time, and whenever he did so, he was reminded of a distant land far, far away. He never quite knew exactly what place it was. Somewhere the princess of his mother's fairy tales lived. A certain joy and wonder would excited his childish mind. And yet, at the very moment when his imaginations had flown him away into his faraway land, he began to miss his mother a lot. It was so strange, as though he would suddenly recall that the land to which he was going was a place without his mother, and right away he would long to remain by her side. It had happened so many times. Unit 2. A kite would be flying high in the skies, growing smaller and smaller and smaller still as it flew over the tall palm in Nilu's garden, before disappearing into the sky. As soon as the speck of the flying kite disappeared, Appu would bring his gaze back to the earth and then find himself running towards the kitchen veranda and in one bound holding his mother in a tight embrace. "Just look at the boy," Sarvojaya would exclaim. "Let go of me. Can't you see? I'm cooking and my hands are messy. Let go of me, my darling. See, I'm frying these prawns just for you. You love them. You love them, don't you? Don't be naughty. Go away." A kite would be flying high in the skies, growing smaller and smaller and smaller still as it flew over the tall palm in Nilu's garden, before disappearing into the sky. As soon as the speck of the flying kite disappeared, Appu would bring his gaze back to the earth and then find himself running towards the kitchen veranda and in one bound holding his mother in a tight embrace. "Just look at the boy," Sarvojaya would exclaim. "Let go of me. Can't you see? I'm cooking and my hands are messy. Let go of me, my darling. See, I'm frying these prawns just for you. You love them. You love them, don't you? Don't be naughty. Go away." Some afternoons, after their meal, his mother lies down on the ground, spreading out one end of her sari and reads in a sing-song voice verses from the Mahabharata. A wide-breasted kite's shrill cry is heard from the top of the coconut tree near their house. Appu, sitting beside his mother by the open window, practices writing his alphabet while listening with all his heart and soul to her recitation from the Mahabharata. He gets completely lost in the world of the epic, especially when they come to the battle of Kurukshetra. The day draws to a close. His mother is up and about to finish her household chores. Appu comes out to the veranda and gazes at the distant people. There he seems to be Karna standing somewhere in that direction, beyond the trees, beneath the open sky. He is still struggling to lift up with both his hands his sunken chariot wheels trapped in the mud. On other days, as he listened to the Mahabharata, Appu felt that there was too little about the war in the poem. He found a way to make up for this and to experience for himself the business of war. Picking up a length of split bamboo as if it was his weapon, he declaimed, and then Drona released 10 arrows at one go, but Arjuna released 200. And then what a mighty battle it was, such a battle. The air turned dark with arrows, and then Arjuna, he leapt off his chariot armed with his shield and sword. And then a terrible battle began. Came Duryodhana, came Bhima. The sky turned black with arrows and nothing could be seen. It was the end of the April, a hot summer's day, by the edge of the jungle where the ruins of their uncle Nilmoni Ray's house lie. Guru Drona is deep in trouble. Arjuna's chariot, flying its Hanuman banner, is almost upon him. A mere blink of an eye stands between him and Arjuna's Gandiva bow, which is about to let loose on him. Some afternoons after their he dreaded that the super weapon, the Brahmastra, will be released any moment now. From the Kuru side, cries of hopelessness and lament rise. What are you up to, Appu? An amused voice from the other side of the jungle cut throughout the silent afternoon. Appu found his sister standing and watching him from the jungle of bushes with their zigzagging branches. She was giggling at his antics. When their eyes met, she said, "You madcap, whatever you are muttering away, all by yourself? And why are you flinging about your arms and walking this way and that?" She ran up to him to plant an affectionate kiss on his soft cheek. "You are really mad. What are you doing?" she demanded to know. A shy Appu tried to ward off her question. "Come on, was I really muttering? No, no." When Durga had finally stopped laughing at him, she said, "Now, come with me." And holding him by the hand, she led him into the woods, only stopping when they had come to a particular spot. He dreaded that, "Do you see how many nonas have ripened on that tree?" She was pointing out to the longish fruit that looked like custard apples. "How do you think we can get them down?" "Oh, so many of them, Didi. Can't we get hold of a split can to bring them down? I'm sure it will do the job. You wait here for me and I will get it," said Appu, darting off. But after he came back with the hooked pole, though he tried their hardest, they could not bring down more than 5 nonas. It was an unusual tall tree, and try as she might, Durga could not get the hooked end to touch the topmost branch, which had the best fruits. "Let's go back home with whatever we have got. We will bring Ma along with us on our way to the bathing ghat. It's sure to be within Ma's reach. Here, give me the nonas. You take the hooked pole. How about putting on a nose ring?" she added, as she began tearing off the white buds of the kalmi creeper that flowered all over the low bushes surrounding them. "Do you see how many nonas have ripened? Come closer and I will put a nose ring on you," she said to her brother. Durga liked putting on these little white flowers to the kalmi, pretending they were nose rings. She would hunt for them in the jungles, and if she found one, she always put one on her nose. In the past, she put them on Appu's nose as well. Appu, however, did not really enjoy doing this. Now, he wished to say that he could do without a nose ring. But he kept quiet because he was afraid of his elder sister. He did not in the least wish to annoy her, because it was she who hunted around in waste lands and brought him the pick of delicious nonas and juicy purple plums when the rains came. She managed to lay her hands on all sorts of things, even those they were forbidden to eat. So, right or wrong, he did not dare disobey his sister. Durga broke off a bird and, using the sticky white fluid that oozed out of the stick, stuck the bird on one of his nostrils. She wore one herself. Then, holding him fondly under the chin, she turned his face towards herself. "Come closer. Let's see how it looks. Oh, that's sweet. Come, let's show it to Ma." "No, no, Didi," Appu tried to protest, quite ashamed of his nose ring. "Why? Let's go. Don't take it off. It looks good." When they got home, Durga laid down all the nonas by the kitchen door. "Where did you get them, dear?" Sarbojaya was busy cooking, but she was very pleased at the sight of the fruits. "They were growing in the lychee jungle, loads of them. Will you come with us and get some tomorrow? They are ripe too, flaming red like sindoor." Then, moving aside to reveal Appu standing behind her with his nose ring, she said, "Look, Ma." "Goodness me, now who can that be?" said Sarbojaya with a laugh. "Let's see how it can't recognize this person." Appu hurriedly took off the bird that hung from his nose. "It's Didi," he said bashfully. "She made me wear it." "Come, Appu, come on," broke in Durga. "I hear the dug-dugi rattling away. Must be the monkey man with his drum. Come quick." In a flash, Durga had run out of the house and closed behind her Appu. But it was not the monkey man. After all, who appeared in the path ahead of them? It was Chini Bash, the sweet maker from the neighboring village. On his rounds to sell the sweets he was carrying, Chini Bash walked past Harihar's door without any attempt to enter the house. He knew the people of this house never bought anything from him. Nevertheless, when he saw Durga and Appu standing at the door, he did ask, "Want any?" Appu looked at her sister, but she shook her head at Chini Bash and said, "No." Bhuvan Mukherjee was a wealthy man. He had about half a dozen stacks of paddy heaped up in his compound. His wife had died a long time before. His widowed sister-in-law, who was called Shijo Bau, or the middle daughter-in-law by all, ran the household. She was over 40 and was well known for her sharp tongue and quick temper. Can't recognize. Shijo Bau bought a whole lot of sweets as offering for her Ganga Puja, all of which she stored in a freshly polished brass bowl. She then bought sweets for the children, Bhuvan Mukherjee's and her own, who were all standing around Chini Bash. When she saw that Durga and Appu had followed Chini Bash into their courtyard, she gave her son Sunil a little tap on his shoulder and said quite loudly, "Why can't you get up on the veranda and eat your sweets? I have bought the offerings for the puja. Can't let any of it get dirty." Chini Bash had now picked up his wares and was setting off for another house. Shijo Bau bought a whole lot of sweets as, "Come, Appu," said Durga. "Let's go to Runu's." The two had barely gone past the outdoor when Shijo Bau made a face and exclaimed, "The girl's such a greedy creature. Got a home, haven't you? Why don't you sit at home and buy something and eat it there? No, they must run from house to house, like mother, like brats." As they came out of Bhuvan Mukherjee's house, Durga tried to comfort her brother. Nothing so great about that chinny bashes sweets. Just wait and see. I'm going to get 4 paise from Baba for the chariot festival. 2 for you and 2 for me. And we will buy heaps of sugar-coated rice. Appu thought about this and after a while, he said, Didi, how long is it before the festival? Vidhuti